Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So it's my great pleasure to have Omer Lev here from the Hebrew University. He's a PhD student with Jeff Rosenstein, who is also my advisor. And he's working on game theory, auctions, and social choice. So he'll be talking about several Nash equilibria in voting games and how to handle that.
All yours. I don't. Actually, mic'd. Yeah. Okay. Hi. Thanks, Yoram. So obviously, there are some results I want to show you. But first of all, I need to explain what voting games are and the exact definition of Nash equilibria, which probably most of you know. I'll just mention it briefly. So first of all, what are voting games in general? So suppose we want to go on a company retreat, we want to go somewhere, and each of us has a preference of where they want to go. In this case, Paris, the Caribbean, or Japan. Now we obviously can do a dictatorship and have one person, say the boss, decide where's the company going this year. But another different option is to ask everyone's opinion and try to somehow find a choice that is acceptable to everyone. So how do we decide? We vote. How do we vote? One voting system, fairly common one, is plurality. We just, each of us gives a point to his favorite option, and we choose the option which has the maximum number of points. In this case, obviously, it doesn't work, because every option has the same number of points, so we need a tie-breaking rule. I'll delve a bit later into tie-breaking rules, but plurality is just one type of voting rule that is a part of a family called scoring rules. Scoring rules are voting rules that are defined using a vector of size m, m being the number of candidates or options in our election. And what it defines is that each voter gives alpha 1 points to his favorite option, alpha 2 points to his second favorite option, alpha 3 points to his third favorite option, and so on, until he gives 0 points to his least favorite option. We then sum all the points that each candidate got, and the candidate with the largest score is our winner. Now, there are several types of prominent scoring rules. Of course, the best known is plurality, which most of us use and is fairly used commonly in elections throughout the world, in which each of us gives a point to his favorite option and zero to everything else. Veto is another common voting rule in which we give every option 1 point except our least favorite option. Borda is more gradual, as for example, if we have 10 candidates, we give 9 points to our favorite option, 8 points to our second favorite, 7 points to our third favorite, and so on. And between plurality and veto, we have K approval and K veto, which are basically sort of an intermediate voting rules between them, in which we have either a fixed number of candidates we give a point to, or a fixed number of candidates we don't give a point to. So these are a family of scoring rules. And this is one way to conduct elections. We just score the points and find the winner. However, we can think of different ways of considering what a winner is. How, not just the guy with the maximal score, but we can think of different ways. For example, a Condorcet winner. It's a different winning concept. Condorcet winner, developed by the concept was developed by Condorcet in the 18th century, defines a winner not by giving points to candidates, but looking at virtual runoffs. We can look at every two candidates and ask ourselves, what is their score? How many people preferred A over B? How many people preferred A over C? How many people preferred A over D? And if we have a candidate that versus every other candidate gets a majority of votes, that is, in a sense, a good winner. A winner that enables the winner to have no opposing coalition coalescing around a different candidate, a stronger candidate. In our example, we didn't have our plurality gave 1 point to every option, but there is a Condorcet winner because two people prefer Paris over the Caribbean and two people prefer Paris over Japan. So in this case, we have a Condorcet winner, that's Paris. Now, as beautiful as this solution concept is, we don't always have Condorcet cylinders. It's fairly easy to devise a situation in which a majority of people prefer A over B, a majority of people prefer B over C, and a majority of people prefer C over A. So we have this cycle, and we don't have a Condorcet winner. Now, we might say, well, okay, we have this limitation, but let's pick a voting rule that is Condorcet consistent. That is, when there is a Condorcet winner, it elects the Condorcet winner. If there isn't, it does something else. Sadly enough, it was, I think, proven already in the early 20th century, that, or even before, that there is no scoring rule that can be Condorcet consistent. Even the example we gave with plurality, it's fairly easy to see it's not Condorcet consistent, since if we add a fourth option of, say, Sao Paulo, and it's everyone's second option, it's obviously the Condorcet winner, since everyone almost always prefers it over other things. However, it receives 0 points. It didn't even merit, it didn't even enter in the tie-breaking rule. So the Condorcet consistent rule cannot be part of our scoring rules, but there can be, there are different Condorcet consistent rules. For example, maximin. Now this, ignore the equation, it looks much more complex than it is. Basically, what maximin does is select the candidate with the largest core supporters. We look at each candidate and ask ourselves, how many people support this in every runoff? We ask ourselves, for candidate A versus candidate B, how many supporters A has? A versus C, how many supporters A has? A versus D, how many supporters A has? And look at the smallest number that A always gets. This is the number of votes A will get in every virtual runoff, regardless of the opponent, of who's running against it. And then we pick the candidate with the maximal score. That is, he has the largest core supporters. Now, this is obviously Condorcet consistent, since Condorcet winner is the only one that has a majority of voters in his core as his core supporters, because he always gets a majority of votes. Now, these are actually the voting rules I'll be talking about, but since I'm here in Britain and it recently had a referendum on voting rules, I can't just ignore what was called here AV, the alternative vote. And it's generally called in the voting community STV, the single transferable vote. And it's actually the voting rules used in elections in Australia, at least a variant of it, and was proposed here but didn't succeed in the referendum. It's a fairly complex voting rules. I just give an example. I won't explain it, and I don't define it. I'll just give an example, and I think it'll explain it better. And our example is going to be selecting the favorite wives of Henry VIII from the first four. And these, we have three people who prefer Catherine of Aragon first, Anne Boleyn second, Jane Seymour third, and Anne of Cleves fourth. We have two people who prefer Anne Boleyn, and that's their order. Two people prefer Jane Seymour, and one person who prefers Anne of Cleves. Now, as you can see, straight up plurality here would select Catherine of Aragon. She has the most number of voters, and she would win in a straight up plurality. However, under STV, we begin with a straight-up plurality. We just allow every voter to give 1 point to their favorite option, and that's what they do. And then we ask ourselves, did anyone win a majority of the votes? Not a plurality, but a majority. In this case, a majority would be four or more, and no one won it. So what we do is we eliminate the candidate with the smallest score. In this case, that's Anne of Cleves. She's gone. And everyone that voted for her transfers their vote to their second favorite option. In this case, that's Jane Seymour. So now we have three people who support Catherine of Aragon, two people who support Anne Boleyn, and three people who support Jane Seymour. Again, no one has a majority of the votes. So we need again to eliminate the candidate with the smallest score. This time, this is Anne Boleyn. So Anne Boleyn is eliminated. Her two voters, again, transfer their vote to their second favorite option. Again, that's Jane Seymour in this case. And now, Catherine of Aragon has three supporters, while Jane Seymour has five. Five is the majority of the votes, and hence, Jane Seymour is the winner. Notice again that the winner under STV is not necessarily the plurality. In this case, it's completely different. And because in plurality, Catherine of Aragon would have won, well, STV would have made Jane Seymour the winner. So that's what I'm talking about. I talked about voting rules enough. I'll just mention Nash Equilibria. Many of you probably know these definitions. I'll just mention it briefly. And what is a pure Nash Equilibria? Basically, in a Nash Equilibrium, each player has a strategy, and knowing everyone else's strategy, they still stick to the strategy. This is a stable situation in which no one, despite the fact that I know that Yoram is going to do this action and somebody else is going to do that action, I still have an action, and none of us want to change the actions. Our actions, despite the fact that we know what everyone else is doing. Now, the regular example for showing a Nash equilibrium is called the prisoner's dilemma. Since we're talking about voters, I'll show a voting prisoner's dilemma. We have three prisoners, and they want to decide what they're going to do. They're either going to escape, they're going to riot, or they're just going to stay in jail. Now, these are their preferences, and they decide to use plurality to decide what to do. But sadly enough, again, they need a tie-breaking rule, since there's no plurality for any option. And suppose our tie-breaking rule is broken by staying in prison. So this is this is their strategy. Everett wants to escape, P wants to riot, Delmar wants to stay in prison, and the resulting action is staying in prison. Is this thing a stable strategy? No. Because Pete thinks if he changes his preference, if he says his preference is not to riot, but rather to escape, then he will improve his situation. There will be a plurality for escaping. He'd rather escape than stay in prison. He directly profits by changing his strategy. Similar, by the way, for Everett, he'd rather riot than stay in jail, so he'd be incentivized to change to rioting. So this, for example, if our tie-breaking rule selected escaping, would have been a Nash equilibrium, since Pete cannot change his strategy to result in a better result for him. He cannot improve over escaping, and neither can Delmar. And by the way, escaping is in this case also a Condorcet winner. Now, why am I talking about Nash equilibria and voting? It's because voting has a dark, deep secret. And the dark, deep secret is called the Gibbert-Sadoway theorem. And it basically tells us that regardless of whatever voting system we choose, except for a dictatorship, every voting system has some scenario in which truthful preferences are not a Nash equilibrium, in which participants need to lie or can improve the results for them by lying. This commonly happens, of course, in elections. For example, in Israel, there's a 2% bar in entering a parliament, despite the fact that a seat requires less than 1% of the vote, and therefore voters are disincentivized from voting to smaller parties because they fear that their vote will be lost if they vote for a party that's a fringe party that doesn't have enough support. Similarly, if I understand correctly, in the first-past-the-post system used here, again, voters are disincentivized from voting to smaller parties because only the candidate that gets a plurality of votes wins. They are incentivized to vote for the larger parties and that way affect the result. So these are obvious examples, but every voting rule has its own example. It's a fairly trivial set of,
So this sort of theorem sort of depends on the preference distribution, right? If there is
no.
a 1-0 preference distribution, the person says, I like this, or I don't really care.
Right. It depends on the fact that each voter has the conditions are, you know, there needs to be a preference order and it needs to be complete and every option should be possible.
Mm-hmm.
If there are impossible options, then the theorem doesn't work and they need to be independent of each other. Events in our lives are usually most elections. We not just political, but also, you know, when we decide where to go to a restaurant, usually these terms are occur and this theorem comes into play. So, since we allow voters, of course, not to tell the truth, then weird things can happen. Not just people are improving their strategy, but when people are at times maybe incentivized not to tell the truth, and sometimes weird equilibria occur. For example, if Everett announces his strategy is staying in prison, as does Pete, as does Delmar, this is a Nash equilibrium. Despite the fact that two of our voters are voting for the least favorite action, This is a Nash equilibrium. None of them can change their strategy and influence the result. Because both Pete and Everett, regardless of what they do, the result will still be staying in prison. And one of the problems we'll talk about later is the fact that we want to, in a sense, eliminate this Nash equilibrium. We don't want to consider these types of equilibria, these nonsensical types. But the first thing I want to consider is iterative voting. And that, in a sense, is a way to reach an equilibrium. We start off from a certain point. This is a case where we only learn of other people's preference not as we vote, but after we vote, and suppose we can change our vote. This mainly occurs in smaller settings. For example, a group of friends want to select a restaurant they're going to, or choose a movie to go to, and people see what other people are saying and change their vote accordingly. Now, the example I'll give, first of all, to explain what iterative voting actually is, suppose the first family in Genesis, Adam, Eve, Cain, Abel, and Seth, want to select a car color. And these are the preferences. Each of them has his own order. And as you can see, they use plurality, and they decide that the small brother, Seth, will be the tiebreaker. And as you can see, they're choosing a red car. And as Adam is about to make the call to the dealership, a call is heard. Hey, wait a minute. And Abel says, you know what? I don't want to vote for a blue car. I want to vote for a green one. So we're going to get a green car now. And again a call is heard. Wait a minute. And Adam says, well, if Abel can do it, so can I. I don't want a red car. I'm saying I want an orange car. And now we're getting an orange car. Now, obviously, this can continue. You can see that Eve, since she'd rather have a green car over an orange one, can again switch to green and change the color again. But the real question we need to ask ourselves is, will this process ever end? Will we at some point reach an equilibrium, or are we doomed to repeat in a cycle what we do and never reach a conclusion? Now, this question was answered in 2010 by a paper by Meir Pulukarov, Jennings, and Rosenshine, and they said something like this. Assuming players are myopic, that means they want to improve the next stage. They're not looking 30 stages in the future, they're just looking at the next stage, and they pursue a best response strategy. That is, if, for example, they can change their vote and make both A and B winners, they will choose to make the change that will make their most preferred candidate the winner. As long as this is our setting, iterative plurality converges. By the way, there is no fixed order on participation. We assume that suddenly someone can call out and change their vote whenever. There's no fixed order. And therefore, iterative plurality converges. That's what they proved.
Were they assuming one person updates vote at a time?
Right. It's not concurrent. It's not concurrent. When it's concurrent, it's very obvious that it will never converge. The examples are pretty easy to see. But yeah, we assume one at a time, but again, not a fixed order. So it's not a fixed rule that we can just say by Gilbert-Sadowitz this will never happen. So they talked about two cases, when there's a random tie-breaking rule, which I won't talk about here. And for a deterministic tie-breaking rule, they talked about the fact that plurality converges if we start from a truthful starting point or not. So even if our initial starting point was already people were trying to manipulate, this will still converge to an equilibrium. Now there's a small caveat, because they didn't just talk about deterministic tie-breaking rules, they talked about linear order tie-breaking rules. Now what does this mean? A linear tie-breaking rule is one in which we have a fixed order between our options. Red over orange over green over whatever, there's always a fixed order. A non-linear tie-breaking rule is more bizarre. For example, if red and orange are tied, red is selected. If red, orange, and green are tied, orange is selected. So there's no fixed order between red and orange that can be easily defined. Now you can think to yourself, when is there ever a non-linear tie-breaking rule? It's a very odd one. But I'll give you an example from my life in Jerusalem. It's very hard to find good brioche in Jerusalem. There's not much. And when I go and search for a brioche, when I enter a bakery or pastry shop, and I see they don't have many French pastries, it's usually preferable to take the bread. It'll be at a good quality, and the brioche would probably be terrible. However, if you enter a bakery and it has many French pastries, like macaroons or croissants or whatever, it usually is better to pick the brioche. You'll be better off, probably, assuming you like brioche. So there's no fixed order between bread and brioche for me. It changes according to other pastries in that bakery, and therefore this is a nonlinear deciding rule for me, and nonlinear voting rules are do exist. So the first thing we wanted to do is to check out whether the tiebreaker rule is even relevant here, because we know that randomized is different than deterministic, but does the linear order give us anything? And we tried checking plurality with just an arbitrary tiebreaking rule, and we're discovering something even worse. Not only does it not work in plurality, an arbitrary tiebreaking rule destroys a convergence for every scoring rule and maximin. It's simply, they won't converge. Each and every scoring rule or maximin has some tiebreaking rule for which it will cycle and never converge. Now, I'll give you just a short example. These are the truthful preferences. This is for general scoring rules, except for veto. I think this does. There's a different example for veto, which I won't show here. But as you can see, the red voter pursues a very simple strategy. He wants some candidate to be the winner. He puts it in first place. He puts in last place the previous winner. And that's a best response strategy for him. And it enables, first of all, the red voter changes, then the blue voter changes his strategy in response. And then the best response for the red voter is actually to revert to his previous truthful preferences, and the blue one reverts as well, and we have a cycle. Now, the example for maximin is, again, quite similar. I'll just point to two things that are different here. First of all, it's much more evident in maximin how what we're actually playing with is just changing the group which is tied, the tied group. We just change how many participants it has. We don't even try to increase, basically, the score in maximin. And just as an example of the fact that maximin is a pretty much a very complex voting rule to deal with, and that's why most further work on it is we're still working on it, is that, for example, this move by the blue voter, he wants to make B the winner, which is his favorite, and his best strategy to do that is put his least favorite candidate in first place, which is extremely counterintuitive and one of the problems we have in actually dealing with maximin in general. So we know tiebreaker rules are crucial for convergence. We know that if we allow arbitrary ones, it never does converge. In linear order, we know that plurality does converge. So maybe if we we limit our tiebreaking rules, maybe we can get more voting rules to converge. Sadly enough, it won't be true in the general sense, because Borda, regardless of tiebreaking rule, does not converge. And this example may seem familiar to you because it's exactly the same example I gave for the scoring rules with arbitrary tiebreaking rules. But in this case, we don't need a tiebreaking rule because the same example, when we use Borda, a specific scoring rule, the winner is always single. The winner is always has the maximal number of points. It's not tied at any point in this cycle. And therefore, no tiebreaking rules even enter consideration. So sadly enough, our initial attempt to prove that general scoring rules converge turns out not to be true. But then we began to think something like this. We know plurality converges under linear tiebreaker rules. Perhaps veto converges as well, because in a sense it's anti-plurality. It has many similar features. Maybe veto does converge. And I admit that one of the initial things that causes this is watching American Idol. I assume there was Pop Idol here before that. And seeing that in the judges, there's some stage there that judges decide who the winners are, and basically they're pursuing an iterative veto. Each of them says no to that, and then someone says, well, if you say no to that, then I change my previous no to I now veto someone else. And it's basically an iterative veto process. So they actually use it. And we want to ask ourselves that there's a situation in which Simon Cowell will never leave the studio because it will not converge, and or will it ever converge? So we found out that when you use linear tie-breaking rules, iterative veto does converge. And I'll show you just a small sketch of the proof. And basically, what first we need to understand about iterative veto is that there's a very simple best response strategy. Veto the current winner. If you veto the current winner, you cannot go wrong. On occasion, there may be other strategies that will result in the same effect, but if you veto the current winner, this will be a best response strategy. Now let's assume there is a cycle. It does not converge and there is a cycle. And let's look at this cycle and pick one stage there that has more than one winner. with the maximal, more than one candidate with the maximal score. So a tiebreaker rule is used. By the way, it's fairly easy to see that there isn't, if there's never a tie-breaking rule, then there's no cycle. But suppose we take one of the stages and pick a stage where the maximal score, let's define it as S. And what this lemma is going to tell us is that every stage in this cycle will have a maximal score of S or S plus 1. No other. And if it's S plus 1, then there's only a single winner. There's only a single candidate with a maximal score. No tie-breaking rule is used. Now, why is that so? It's so because there is a certain futility to being a single winner. If you're a winner, if you're the only one with the maximal score, there's only two possibilities of the next stage. You'll definitely lose a point, because our best response is always veto the current winner, and someone else will gain it. Now, if he'll gain a point and he didn't have S points before, then the maximal score has been lowered. The other possibility is that you've been vetoed and someone else gains a point and has the same score as you do. So when you're a single winner, the possibility of advancement is either lowering the maximal score or remaining the same with a single winner. It can never increase. So if we have a situation where the maximal score is S with more than one voter, it can never go beyond S plus 1, because in order to get to S plus 1, we'll start with candidate gets S plus 1 points, and as we show, it can advance beyond that. And it can never go below S, because in order to get back to S, someone will need to be a single winner with S points, and we can't get back into the situation in which we have two candidates or more with S points. So that's this uncertain. This is what proves the first lemma. Now we delve further into the buildup of this. Yeah.
So vetoing the current winner is a best response strategy. Is it the only one?
It's not the only one, but it's the only. By the way, it's the only consistent one. If we allow different strategies on occasion, it actually can converge. But since due to the fact that you can have several options, it can converge. But both in the work on plurality, which Reshef and Maria Plukarev did, the analysis of this is not only easier when we assume single winner, it's also we do believe that it does, that's how basically people will act. We think that it's fairly close approximation of what people will actually do.
But it's not a statement about any myopic strategy, it's about this particular myopic
strategy.
You feel that it's...
Yeah, we feel that, it has merit, but yeah. Yes, generally, if we allow any best response strategy with no specific guidelines to it, ties can be broken in ways that will actually allow cycles to occur. They are usually very small, odd ones.
Is this equivalent in the setting just assuming people only do strictly better best replies, right? Because anything that's not vetoing the current winner has no immediate change on the outcome.
No, we assume they always... No, you can change the outcome. For example, if you currently veto someone that's, you know, has no... is tied with another one and is... for example, if you currently veto a candidate which is tied with the winning veto... with a winning veto... two candidates tied with a maximal score, and you're vetoing one of them. And you can either now veto the current winner and give your candidate a point, but you don't need to veto the current winner. As long as you give the who you're vetoing now a point, you've done what you can. You can veto just any random candidate, and you've changed the result. But as a persistent strategy, that's, you know, sometimes you can do it, sometimes you can't. If you veto the current winner, that's always a best response. Anyway, when we delve further into this buildup of the iterative veto, we can see that when we look at all stages which have S as the maximal score, the number of candidates with S points remains the same throughout. The number of candidates with S minus 1 points remains the same throughout. And the candidates themselves, not the number, with S or S minus 1 points, are the same throughout the whole cycle. Why? Because if you think about it, in order for a candidate to leave this group of S or S minus 1 points, It needs to be, the only way to lose a point, of course, is by winning the winner, because we only veto the current winners. And you need to be with S minus 1 points, and then lose a point and leave this group. However, in order to lose a point, you need to be the winner, and you can't be a winner with S minus 1 points. That's what our previous lemma showed. So they never leave this group. Furthermore, since our points are only changing between these candidates with S points and S minus 1 points, this is basically a zero-sum game. So the number of candidates with S or S minus 1 points needs to remain the same, or otherwise, I don't know, points just arrive out of nowhere. So that's why this lemma is true. Now, I won't go into further lemmas we had in the proof, but basically these two, along with the third stage, lead us to realize that there are only two types of player moves. Either you give a point to a candidate with S points and he becomes a winner with S plus 1 points, or you give a point to a candidate with S minus 1 points and he becomes a winner with S points. So the guy, or the candidate you're giving a point to, is the one that will become a winner. And this means that basically your situation is getting progressively worse. First of all, A was the winner. He said, oh, I hate A, I'll veto him. Then several stages later, B was the winner, and you said, you know what, I hate B even more. I'll veto B, which means I'm giving a point to A, and that means A becomes the winner, which means B was worse for me than A, so I now veto B. Then several stages later, C is the winner, and you say, C, I hate it even worse than B. I'll veto C, giving B a point, making him the winner, and that continues along until basically you vetoed your least favorite option, and you'll never make another step again, because there'll never be a situation in which you'll want to make your least favorite candidate the winner. So this is a finite process which contradicts our initial assumption that iterative plurality didn't converge, and therefore it does, and Simon Cowell can leave the room eventually when he finishes. So we know that iterative plurality converges. We knew iterative veto converges. So we thought, hey, there are all this family of voting rules between them, this K veto, K approval. These are great candidates for converging. Sadly enough, they do not. None of them do. Actually, in our paper, we showed this for K larger or equal to 3. We've managed to prove that not even when K equals 2, it doesn't converge either. And basically the strategies they pursue here is one of them wants to utilize the tie-breaking rule very intensively and make everyone tied. So his favorite among the tied will become a winner, while the red voter here tries to make someone be a true a single winner with the maximum number of points.
So theorem stands for K is equal to 2, right?
It's for K equal to 2, but basically you can add dummy candidates as much as you want. You can add add voters, and you know there are candidates which only one person votes for, so they have no chance. And when you have enough dummy candidates, you can make this true for any K.
What if the number of candidates is large, the number of candidates is small relative to the number of voters, which rules out that particular
you can
embedding?
Basically, if you increase the number of, if you allow yourself to increase the number of voters as much as you want, you can make for any K the voting rule cycle, because you can make enough dummy candidates with enough voters.
But I want to restrict you to have a small number of candidates.
Right, I'm showing for K equals 2. This case is when K equals 2. The question was, if I understand correctly, if this stands in for larger Ks.
Here your case is 2 voters, 4 candidates.
4 candidates, but K equals 2. That is, this is the voting rule 2 approval or 2 veto in this case. They're equivalent.
Maybe I just said the wrong word. I meant, if you have a lot of voters and not many candidates, do these bad results still apply?
Yes, actually, for example, here you can simply increase. You could add voters and make just everyone tied, and so these two are actually the only ones playing. And this cycle still occurs. Obviously, when there are enough voters in, you know, true large type elections, you can see situation with basically the differences between each candidate are such that no single voter can make a change that will make an effect. But, you know, even in the Iowa primaries, in the Republican primaries this year, there was, in the whole state of Iowa, 8 points difference between the two leading candidates, which, if they were using a voting rule which wasn't plurality, could have been, I mean, if they were using Borda, one voter could have changed that, actually. Borda is, by the way, one where won't delve into here, but we're working on, we know that iterative Borda straight up does not converge. But we're trying to see if under different strategies, we call it a lazy best response, maybe it does converge if we limit the strategies we allow the voters. But I will get into it here because I actually want to go into something else as well, and that's, I talk about this whole process of how we reach an equilibrium eventually, this iterative process, but I actually didn't tell you about these whole equilibria. Looking at, we have this whole equilibria, and you know there's one process that reaches one of them, but what are the properties of these equilibria? Are the winners good? Are the winners bad? How many are there? And this is work we empirical work we've done with David Thompson from the University of British Columbia, and came really around his supervisor and my supervisor as well. And we encountered two problems. One problem was how the number of silly equilibria, in a sense, like the one I've shown before, where even if all voters hate the same candidate as have the same candidate as the least favorite option, everyone hates the same guy. When everyone votes for this guy, this is still a Nash equilibrium, because no single voter, by changing his strategy, can change the outcome. And therefore, this is an equilibrium. And in a sense, we want to say, well, we don't want to consider these equilibria. They never happen. We want to eliminate them from our analysis. And the way we thought of doing this is adding something called the truthfulness incentive. And the truthfulness incentive is a very small utility that the voter gets when he votes truthfully. Now, this needs to be very small, because we want to retain the fact that a voter is incentivized to change the winner. If a voter can influence the outcome, we want him to do it. If the voter knows that if he changes his vote to something that changes the outcome, we want him to be incentivized to choose according to his preferences. So the truthfulness incentive needs to be very small. We do, however, of course, want to make it more than zero, since we want it to be to change. We don't, for example, in the example I gave before, when everyone voted to stay in prison, now both for Pete and Everett, they say, why do I want to stay in prison? I mean, it's true that this is a Nash equilibrium, and I can't, and you know, me changing my vote doesn't make an effect, but I hate this option. I might as well, may the result be stay in prison as it may, I'm still changing my vote to rioting, or in Everett's case, to escaping. So this eliminates these types of equilibrium. I still haven't told you how many it eliminates and whether it's, you know, worthwhile or not. Yeah.
But so in this example, like an equally plausible reason for why this is a silly equilibrium is that both Pete and Everett are indifferent between their strategies, because if only one of them chooses to stay in prison, we'll still win. Correct?
Right.
So, I mean, this is just saying it's weakly dominated by me truthfully reporting in this case.
It's weakly, yeah, it's weakly dominating.
And so, I mean, it seems very, like, why do I believe this epsilon thing is just the weakly dominated outcome?
No, the epsilon thing really dominates, it truly dominates. In this case, vote rioting dominates staying in prison, no longer weakly, but strongly dominates.
Right, but I'm saying, like, so you're saying here's one concept, we give you epsilon if you tell the truth, right? And I'm saying here's another concept, just focus on non-weakly dominated.
And the thing is that in many cases, first of all, finding weakly dominated is a problem. And obviously, the next problem we need to handle is actually how we find equilibrium. Just every equilibria in existence in a certain game, that's not a simple problem. And weakly dominated have a problem, not just the fact that we don't have a good algorithm to find them, but I think that in certain cases, there can be bizarre. I remember seeing something. I remember hearing a talk about against weakly dominated strategy in these cases. I just remember his precise example, which he gave, that this is a bizarre case, and you know, we'd rather not look at this equilibrium. I just don't remember the example right now.
Okay.
So,
I mean, in this case, right, Everett, you're considering the case when people don't know the preference order of others.
No, in this case, they don't know the order. They know what they vote, but
they don't know the.
They know how people are voting. They know the result.
Why would not Everett vote for, say, riot or escape? Because he assumes that in the
maybe there are, I mean, this is obviously a simplifying example, but obviously there can be cases in which voters are incentivized not because they have a certain belief on the world around them that makes them think that, you know, I don't know, they think that, suppose there are many more voters and they think that escaping and rioting is just, they won't get any vote, and there are worst options like, I don't know, moving to a high security prison and, I don't know, killing someone or whatever.
But here's the issue, right? So in the previous example where you were sort of telling us about that theorem that you can just essentially veto the winning person and then nothing will happen. If you knew what everybody's preference
right.
order is...
If you knew what everyone else is working on, what everyone else thinks, then you can actually calculate your own equilibrium.
Yep.
But usually, for example, in the iterative process, you don't know. We definitely assume the fact that you don't know. What, for example, we're working on now is trying to see if we can attach a learning algorithm to this because, you know, people are changing the votes and that gives you information on their preferences.
Mm-hmm.
And until now, we don't have actual results
for
that.
So the model sort of assumes that each agent is behaving for just his own action. He's not looking ahead.
Right.
Even one action.
Even
of
one.
Other,
right. I know that Maria Pilcaro from Southampton is currently working on an attempt to change the myopic version of the iterative process.
Mm-hmm.
So they are working. So there are different groups that are working on that. Mm-hmm. But in this case, I mean, it's straight up Nash equilibrium. It's not even an iterative process. That we just want to not. We'd want to look at the game and say, this is not a real equilibrium. This doesn't exist in our game. This nonsensical option does not exist. And the second option, obviously, we need to deal with is actually being able to take a game and find all its equilibria. Now, I'll give you the numbers where we have 5 candidates and 10 voters. The number of equilibria is above 300,000. So actually finding them is pretty much a pain. But the solution was using AGGs. This is not a new concept. This was, I think, defined in 2008. AGGs, or action graph games, are a way to represent a game in a graph manner, a compact way. And it depends on 2 properties, one of them being anonymity, that basically every voter's utility depends on what he does and how many people do other things. So I don't care if person X votes for A and person Y votes for B. I want to know how many people vote for A, how many people vote for B. And this is extremely fitting to voting. In voting games, usually we have this anonymity property. We don't care who does well. We care how many people do whatever action. And it needs a property of being easily calculable. And for example, scoring rules, that's almost always true for them.
So that doesn't always happen to some of your tie-breaking rules, right? You had tie-breaking rules
But in this case, we used a linear order tie-breaking rule. For our empirical runs here, we used an empirical one, a linear order one. And yes, true. But it is still, by the way, fairly easily calculable because, you know, if the number is A, B, and C, we can actually introduce every tie-breaking rule. We introduced a random one for, we hope, a future paper, but it's not yet written. It's still calculable fairly well for even a random tie-breaking rule. We don't need to be the tie-breaking rule to be simple. We need the actually voting result to be easily calculable. And once we represent our game as an AGG, we can use well-known algorithms that support enumeration method to find all the equilibria. Now, since our AGGs are compact, the support enumeration method runs on it pretty fast, and the support enumeration method is, in worst case, exponential, but in most cases, it's polynomial. So due to its heuristics, and for our usage, it was very good. So we have a way to find the equilibria, and we have a way to eliminate some of the nonsensical options. So let's see what we got. So we have the scenario, we have 5 voters and 10 candidates. We already expanded that from then, but I'll present this. And each of our voters, we randomly assign for him a preference order. And he has a utility function, which is border-like. We have 5 candidates, so if his favorite candidate wins, he gets a utility of 4. If his second favorite candidate wins, he gets a utility of 3. If his third favorite gets a utility of 1, and so on. And we have a very small truthfulness incentive. This is 10 to the power of -6. Obviously, if our voter can influence the result, he would choose to do that even by not voting truthfully. The truthfulness incentive, if the voter has a possibility of changing the vote, he will pursue it.
Does it really have to be the 1/1,000,000 or any?
No, it can be anything like half, third will work. Anything third. Less than half would probably work here. What we want to be on the safe side. anyway, we look at each game, we check all its equilibria, and we run 1,000 times. Yeah.
What's my utility? Like, because now I'm adding in a number, and I'm saying this is better than.
I'm saying if your favorite results wins, you get a utility. If your first preference wins, you get a utility of 4. And if you also vote truthfully, you get 4 plus epsilon plus the 10 by minus 6.
What does truthfully mean in this context?
Are you it's plurality. So each of them has a personal preference order, and they have something that they vote for. There's the strategy they're announcing to the world. Because in a voting game,
I'm asking is what is announced their full preference order, or in the case of plurality, just one
since
candidate?
Since we're only using plurality, we don't care about the full preference order. They have a full preference order, we know it, but what they're announcing to the world is just what they're voting for.
So, because I think then you're not eliminating all stupid equilibria necessarily.
Right. I think basically the algorithm actually does. Since we're running it now with Borda, it definitely runs with also presenting
now,
all the information.
Question is, what do you consider to get this truthfulness bonus incentive? Do you have to give the point? It's plurality, right? So do you
you need to vote. You need to offer. You can basically, since you want to get this bonus, you can just say whatever you vote. I mean, you can just say your favorite option. You don't need to announce anything else but your first.
But there are cases, I think, where.
In plurality?
In plurality?
No. In Borda, definitely. But in plurality, no.
There's no cases where with tie-breaking, there could be two things that are not my favorite thing that I'm indifferent between voting for, but I strictly prefer voting for either of those to voting for my preferred candidate.
There can be cases, if I understand correctly, that you vote for not your truthfulness, not your truthful vote, in order to change the winner. And this is obviously supported here because the utility they get from changing the winner is much larger than the truthfulness incentive.
Right, no, but the example I have in mind is say that you can either vote for your second or your third
favorite
candidate to get the desired.
Oh, no, they don't get the truthfulness incentive. No. They don't get it.
So then in some sense, there may you could think of having something
a
graduated truthfulness incentive. Epsilon squared, epsilon cubed, etc.
Yes.
And the question is whether that actually rules out more equilibrium.
Actually, that's
or
interesting.
Not
that's
in
interesting point. We haven't tried that. I admit that we're currently running on, we're trying to see if our results are robust enough so far. They've shown they have it. Yeah, that's an interesting direction to pursue in checking how close, in a sense, to your truthful preferences are you. Some sort of metric also can be employed here. We're thinking about that as well. So what are the results? First of all...
Where does the utility of 4 come from? It's like it's
we just
number.
Selected it. I mean, we just gave it Borda 1. What matters here, we also ran a Bayes-Nash case, which I won't delve here because I won't have the time to explain Bayes-Nash and all that. In the Bayes-Nash case... it matters the actual sizes, but in this case, mostly we need cardinality, and we need it to be very. We need the truthfulness to be small in comparison. But basically, we require just the cardinality. The actual specific values are less important.
So, in Bayes-Nash, would you want to then switch this cardinal truthfulness into sort of lexicographic preferences? So
no, we actually used it still like this. But I'm saying that the actual numbers of Borda were. The actual choice of sizes here, 4, 3, 2, 1, may have been important.
But the actual value of epsilon would also matter in
No, we assume they pursue a pure strategy. Their information about everyone else is a Bayes.
Yeah, but it could be the case that it's expectancies that you're going to compute
right.
in Bayes-Nash. The expectancy is extremely small. Extremely small.
Right. In that case, yes, definitely. And we actually, in this case, it's one of the points where the empirical results really helped us, because seeing some of the results in the Bayes-Nash case, we actually managed to prove a theorem, because it actually made us realize the actual underlying dynamics in the game. And we just by seeing the results, it pulled us toward several theorems, and we were able to devise according to the size of epsilon.
Uh-huh. Well, so, I mean, in some sense, you could view epsilon as an approximation for saying what you really want is you have a first order concern and a second order concern, and really the natural representation of your preferences then is lexicographic, right? Which don't have a utility function.
Right. A certain cardinality in that sense.
Yeah, but for Bayes Nash, you'd have to have proper utility.
Right, for Bayes Nash,
No, you bet Bayes Nash, I mean, could be, I think you can, it's still well defined with lexicographic. It's you prefer the thing that gives you the.
But how
highest,
much do you prefer?
The highest expected value, and then if two things tie on expected then you look at expectations over where you voted or what have you.
Right, maybe then.
So it's really, that would be taking the limit of where epsilon approaches zero and running the same.
Yeah, it's the limit as epsilon goes to zero.
You're right.
Which is really what...
Which happens without a truthfulness incentive, obviously. And in that case, obviously, the number of equilibria explodes. And
it never actually zero, so you don't get this explosion because they're all, with lexicographic, there will always be this.
Right.
Drift.
When it's different than zero, there will be a point, a cutoff point, and there won't be this explosion. And actually, we see some interesting features in Bayes-Nash. Get into that later because it's not explained here. But there's coalescing of small equilibria. But what we saw, the number of equilibria is basically that more than 95% of the games had less than 10 equilibria. From hundreds of thousands, we'd gone down to less than 10. In most cases, some got to 140, but most got to 10. But one of the interesting results here, there were cases, 1.1% of cases had no equilibrium at all, none. And that's... obviously, it's very different because without the truthfulness incentive, there's always an equilibrium in voting games, pure equilibrium in voting games, just everyone votes for the same guy. And it does hold some problems for models like the one I just presented, the iterative model, because the iterative model works on the assumption that there is some equilibrium we will reach at the end, but if there isn't one, it's basically pointless, the whole point of the process. So that's regarding the number of equilibria. And looking at the results, this is basically a division according to the number of equilibria. What percentage was truthful, what percentage was a Condorcet winner. Now regarding truthful winners, more than 41% of the equilibria on average had as their result the truthful winner. The same winner that would have won if we would have voted according to our truthful preferences won in more than 41% of the games. Just as a comparison, when we tried to run a small subset of these experiments without the truthfulness incentive, it dropped to about 21%, which is basically the same as just randomly assigning, since we have five voters, randomly assigning an equilibrium to each one of them, just a fifth of the equilibria. And as I said, truthfulness is more than 41%. Condorcet is above 40% as well. Of the equilibria on average were the Condorcet winners, where there was a Condorcet winner. But we can actually have enough data to look even more fine-grained. We can look at every candidate and ask ourselves, what is their average rank? We know the truthful preferences. We can actually calculate what's the average rank of every candidate. And there we see the numbers are, in a sense, great because more than 50% of the games had all of their equilibria, all of it, with an above median candidate. So the winners in all the equilibria of more than 50% of the games had no winner from the bottom half of the candidates. And 71% of winners were on average above median in general. So in a sense, the quality of winners, when we introduced this truthfulness incentive, which was initially introduced by us for calculability issues, seems to truly improve, and we do believe that it approximates better what people actually do. It enables us to see that the equilibria are actually of a high quality. It's no longer, as like this purple bar, almost a random assignment between each candidate, but it's rather concentrated more on higher quality candidates. Condorcet, truthful, simply higher ranked ones. And also we checked just raw social welfare. In more than 90% of the games, the candidate which resulted in the worst social welfare case there was no equilibrium which resulted in that candidate. Of course, without the truthless incentive, there is always an equilibrium for every candidate. And only in less than 30% was the best result not available as an equilibrium. Just a small point about all these experiments, it's fairly rare to see papers in voting with empirical work. There are some, but it's not very common. We do believe that it is a worthwhile avenue to pursue, worthwhile path. We think that a truthful incentive is actually not only useful in empirical senses, because we believe it's actually useful in general analysis of how people actually work and think, and introducing a theoretical concept. And I can say that using it, we proved some theorems in the Bayes-Nash case. And we like the fact that we saw this clustering in the experiments. We saw this sort of clustering around quality candidates. In the Bayes-Nash case, we saw a clustering around a very small support in the equilibrium. We didn't see equilibria which had people voting for all five candidates, but people voting for only two of the candidates, though all the voters are voting for either one of two candidates or three candidates. And this clustering is something we believe is worthwhile more of pursuing further. And that's it. They escaped eventually, by the way.
Given the time, I guess. If anyone wants to go, just go ahead. And then if you have some more questions, then Omar is still around.
Yeah.
I guess you do have questions.
Yes. I mean, have you looked at maybe giving one player, or maybe if there's a lot of players, a subset of players, a little bit more information about the rest and make them kind of a leader in a game instead of the incentive that you give them?
No. We haven't looked at it because basically we're looking at mostly symmetric equilibrium.
In that case, you can steer maybe.
Actually, we're thinking about it in iterative veto, not in the empirical work. We're thinking about it in the iterative process. We're thinking about, in order to eliminate the myopic version, we're thinking, okay, how do they work in the non-myopic version? In a sense, there needs to be a leader that says, okay, I'm changing my vote to this guy who won't become a winner yet, but it indicates the fact that he wants to push a voter to a certain direction. For example, if the difference between the current winner and the runner-up is 3 points, and we're using plurality, and no single voter can make the change, and iterative-wise, okay, we reach an equilibrium, no one can make a change. Equilibrium, no one can make a change. We're thinking, suppose we had a certain leader that decides, okay, I'm changing my vote to this guy. Suppose there are several with the same score as runner-ups. I'm changing my vote to this guy, and in the sense that thus pushing everyone that prefers that guy over the current winner to vote for him, and everyone changes their vote to that. And despite the fact that one move wasn't enough,
eliminate the bad equilibria.
I think that having a leader, again, it's more relevant for there's a name for when a group can divert, just. Pot of my head, and when a group can diverge from a Nash equilibrium.
Strong Nash.
And it's more of a there, and we haven't considered it yet. I don't think we currently have the computing algorithm to calculate it.
It's a normal, everyone is myopic, but one guy knows more about the rest. Like, he knows what they want as well, their preferences, or like part of their preferences.
Mm-hmm.
So his decision is kind of the social, you can make his decision the social welfare decision, kind of. And he can steer the rest, even if they behave in myopic ways.
I think such a thing needs to be formalized more. I mean, what exactly is he leading? How many people pursue it? I mean, maybe we should take it offline, but I mean, it's something that needs to be, maybe I'm not understanding fully, but I think it needs to be exactly defined what exactly is the process, and only then can you build something around that, it seems to me. Yeah, you have a question?
This is very interesting. I was sort of looking at when you sort of approached, formulated the original problem, it looked very similar to sort of an optimization problem in how basically message passing algorithms come to a particular solution of a a Markov random field or a discrete optimization mm-hmm. problem. So they essentially pass messages, which are essentially can be seen as they are essentially voting for particular states
mm-hmm.
of different variables. Now, one sort of thing that sort of came to my mind was, if you generalize the notion of voting in the sense that people are allowed to not vote, right? So in the K approval, you basically say, I'm not voting, right? I'm abstaining in mm-hmm. some sense,
yeah.
right? And for actually participating in the vote, and every time you actually change your vote, you have to pay a cost.
Abstaining has, I mean, I know Edith Elkin does some work on abstentions in voting, mm-hmm. and there are some interesting results there that something go completely haywire and
now,
some...
But here it's not exactly the case, right? Because you're giving, you have to, if it's K approval, you have to give some candidates points. Even if, you know, you really don't want to give these candidates points because it's helping them, and these are all candidates you hate, that sometimes you will have to select who to give it to.
No,
you're saying abstaining. You're saying I don't care. I'm not participating.
Care.
You decide. I don't
yeah,
care.
Yeah, exactly.
And
you're not really allowing this in this model, right?
No, you're not. But the point is, I'm saying if you change the model such that you allow presentations,
I think in that case it won't converge at all in the iterative process. I mean, almost every change we introduce.
But here's the thing. If you
oh, because changing right has
and
a cost.
Then you pay a cost for participation.
Yes. Then we also need to add utilities to the voters.
Exactly.
And they need to have strict utilities in order to see when. Right. I mean.
So this is sort of this is very close to a regularization mechanism that people use in decomposition-based optimization methods.
Right.
So when they introduce a cost, it sometimes becomes more stable and the optimization algorithm stops going from a loop.
Right, but then it will always stop going from a loop, right?
Exactly.
When you introduce it, it will always eventually rest somewhere, even if it's not in equilibrium.
Exactly. So it might be interesting because this is sort of a mechanism which can be implemented because you can say, guys, in fact, people sort of go to polling booths and they actually pay a cost, right?
Right, but they don't change. They don't have an iterative process.
No, suppose we allow iterative process and say, you have to go to the polling booth, which is 10 miles away from your home,
right,
every time you want to change your cost. And at some point, you will say, okay, I don't really care. I have enough. In fact, people sort of do this already. They say, I don't really care. The person who is about to win is winning already, right? The person who I really like
yeah.
to win is winning already. I will not go. But
right.
but they are sort of assuming that the belief of
right. There are also there's some very interesting work on actually when we have certain information. For example, if we have a poll that gives us some range, what do we do? And that I think Ole Andres from Amsterdam University did some work on this, and Vince Konitzer as well from Duke, and they have some. I mean, it's out there and people are working on it. I admit that. I want to get in there, but I'm not, you know, this held me up. Work on auctions held me up. I agree. These directions are...
Simulation to run, because you already have sort of the code. Just add a participation cost, and each participant
Actually, we're adding. I know that Dave is, you know, I know that Dave is running that. I don't know if as we speak or maybe finished last night and I didn't see the email yet or it'll run next week, but we are talking about it. We are not actually an iteration cost, but a participation cost is definitely something, or probability, it doesn't matter for us,
mm-hmm.
Is something we're introducing, and we definitely think that it's interesting to see how that plays out. Yeah, I don't know.
So all the graphs that you showed us with the statistical results, how much do you think it's very specific to the uniform?
Oh, that actually we checked other voting rules, other candidates and voter numbers, and it holds.
Well, yeah, but I meant the distribution over preferences. Were those always random permutations?
And we always in the base case.
I suppose some permutations are more probable than others.
Yeah, like I'm simulating random voters who have preferences.
Oh, right. We didn't examine. We planned to.
So those results are always for I have a uniformly random
right.
permutation.
And obviously, when we assume actually build up, like, you know, single peak preferences, everything becomes much simpler. For example, in single peak preferences, where you have, like, you can map them around all the options around the on a single-dimensional axis, and you know preferences are always single peak. They choose one point in the single dimension, and everything just you know everything that's far from that point is worst for them. So single peak preference, for example, Gibbard-Sadoweth isn't true for them. If you only limit yourself to there, so for example, Gibbard-Sadoweth isn't even true. You can actually devise voting systems which are strategy proof for these types. But we are working on it because when we don't limit ourselves to single peak, but also you know have more dimensions and all that, we think that it may actually have interesting results. But we're not there. That's on our to-do list. Yeah.
So congestion games are sort of very like pretty examples of the games that have like best response dynamics and like get to like pure equilibria. And so the type of analysis that you explained, which was you know the whole like S and S minus one sort of thing, it felt like you're essentially talking about a potential function that sort of.
I was going to make the same comment, and the reason it would kind of break down with when you have more than one, but it only works at the extremes
right.
with one guy. Is you sort of break down the ability to define that potential function because now you're putting your weight on two things in a weird non.
Actually, Maria Pulkarev, when she started work on iterative plurality, one of the incentives she had was actually trying to define a potential function because she thought it may be just you know find a potential function and everything just is so elegant and beautiful.
But
and
right
then
now you don't know
and
if there's an equivalence to a potential.
And
function.
We don't. We know there are cases where it's not a potential game. There's no potential function. If there's some. Not expansion, some generalized version of potential, we haven't been able to find some way to generalize it well enough to make a little, but we are minded to that similarity, I must say.
It doesn't really seem like a potential, in my opinion. Take that for what it's worth, but because potential games, you never have sorts of cycles, and intuitively it seems that cycles are something that would occur quite regularly.
No, but in order to prove convergence, if we could find a potential function, that would be great.
But it doesn't work.
There's no cycle, right?
Right.
So
in the case that does work, there are no cycles there, so it does seem very plausible that the cases where it works are exactly the cases where you can find a potential function.
Yeah,
but that was for a particular myopic best response strategy. Like he said, if you use another sort of best response, then you can get cycles and potential games so that any best responses converge. So any improvement in the local potential function gets you to the global optimum. And this is saying, well, here's a strategy, but there are other strategies that don't get that, and that would imply it's not a potential function.
But what is best responsible? It is sort of myopic in potential games, right? So you say, fixing everyone else's strategy, this is my best response.
Is that
stop the recording here.
I think what you meant is that since there can be a best response strategy which isn't defined or this rule is always vetoing the current winner, but on occasion, as I said before, you can suddenly, a move becomes apparent that gets the same result but isn't vetoing the current winner. In that case, as I said, we can find there are, I think we found one case that we found converging. We just ran several tens of thousands of experiments to verify that it does exist, and we found something that did exist. And since there is some best strategy choices that lead to a cycle, since they don't use the just veto the current winner strategy, in that case, since that exists, then there's no potential function because the potential function assumes it can never cycle with the best response. Okay. Anything else?
Thanks again.